Good morning, everybody. It's an honor to be with you today. My name is Connor Morgan, and I am glad to be representing as the student body president and as a political science student who has already enjoyed having classes in this wonderful new facility this semester.
Hi, everyone. My name is Amy Lorette, and I am representing here today as a student in both the School of Cultural and Social Transformation and the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences.
On behalf of the students of the University of Utah, I would like to thank Carolyn and Kem Gardner and our other donors for their incredibly generous donations to make our campus an even better place. Thank you for helping to give us a space where current and future students will be able to discover their passions, gain opportunities, and make an impact on the world.
From our new Welcome and Student Success Centers to a reimagined Hinckley Institute of Politics, to the Office for Global Engagement, to its dining facilities and open study areas, to its plethora of teaching spaces, the Gardner Commons provides spaces for students to partake in new experiences, to come together to collaborate, study, and socialize, and to better engage with their university. These opportunities are vital to student success, and by helping to break down silos between departments and offices, they will help students have more successful careers at the University of Utah.
We would also like to thank President Watkins and Dean Berg for their advocacy and vision in working with my predecessors and with students to help make this building a reality. President Watkins, then our Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, and Dean Berg visited with students to ask for their support to construct Carolyn and Kem Gardner Commons. Their request was met with resounding support from the student body. So I'm here today to thank students too for their willingness to help create this new space. Not only is the campus's new main classroom building, but as a University of Utah hub, landmark, and jewel. Thank you.
Connor and Amy, thank you so much, and they are absolutely right. Students have been instrumental in the development of this building from the beginning. I'm gonna just look at Madison for a minute, Madison and I went to visit the legislature together, which is an experience we both remember well. I think there's no question that the voice of students, the input of students, has made this a great building. So I want to acknowledge that and express my appreciation. So welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for the celebration of a very, very special building. And maybe even more important than the building, the very special people that made this building a reality. 2 years ago, when we celebrated the groundbreaking for this remarkable facility with many of the friends and supporters who are with us today, it's a testament to the strength of this university that so many of you have contributed to the creation of this great facility and the programs that are thriving here within it. As we all know, projects like this do not just happen. They come into being because of the vision and the commitment of loyal friends and alumni. The University of Utah has no better friends than Carolyn and Kem Gardner. Let's pause for a minute and acknowledge that. The incredible programs and student spaces that are housed here would quite simply not exist today without the support of Carolyn and Kem Gardner. You have made this possible. We are so grateful that you have done so. For decades to come, students will gather here in these spaces. They will advance their education, and they will learn, and they will socialize, and maybe just as you two did while they're at the University of Utah, they will meet a partner for life. On behalf of the students, faculty, researchers, and staff who have already called this space home, we thank you, Carolyn and Kem Gardner, and we hope that you will visit often to see the magic that is happening in this building. It is a remarkable place indeed. We also are so appreciative of many others who have helped us make this new Center of Learning a possibility. You will find many donors listed in the printed program. I'd like to give a few special thanks now. The Emma Eccles Jones Foundation, which has made possible the beautiful Welcome Center that you saw as you entered the building today. And I want to just comment on this because the Welcome Center in Carolyn and Kem Gardner Commons is used every single day at 10 and 1. and that's used at 10 and 1 every day, as we greet and welcome prospective students and their parents and families to our campus. We now have a place that we can showcase the excellence of the University of Utah in a much more fitting way than we ever could in the past. We're very grateful for that. We also want to thank the John H. and Mary Wilkes Short Family Foundation for their naming gift of the Interdisciplinary Exchange for Utah Science, otherwise known as Nexus. This is an interdisciplinary space that will bring researchers together to solve problems in society. To Rocco Siciliano and the Siciliano family, many of whom are with us today, for this beautiful auditorium. It recognizes Rocco's remarkable legacy of public service. I want to share with you that Rocco, a great friend of the university, passed away earlier this week, on Election Day, I believe, making this occasion bittersweet. I want his family to know how honored we are to be able to celebrate his memory here in this space. This is a very heavily used space every day, many, many students coming and going from here. His life was the very model of public service and will, I'm sure, be a source of inspiration for generations to come. I'd like to acknowledge the George S. and Dolores Dory Eccles Foundation for their generosity in creating the beautiful multi-purpose classroom, auditorium, and special event space. It's located directly above us. It is also very heavily used, has beautiful views, and is a wonderful space making great things happen on this campus. To Pete and Kathy Meldrum and the Meldrum Foundation for making possible the Meldrum Ancient and Modern DNA Laboratories upstairs. So I hope you'll go on a tour and see the DNA lab. And to Jim and Lynn Hinckley for continuing the long-standing Hinckley family friendship with you, most especially through their support of the wonderful new home for the Hinckley Institute of Politics. Thank you all. There are many, many people in this room who are part of this building. Many of you are part of the history of the past of the building that was in this space, and many of you of the future for the wonderful things that will happen here. It is a remarkable thing to have a campus building come into being so quickly. As we think about 2 years ago, when we broke ground for this building, to be active and in this space this fall semester. Thank you very much. Now, we know that these monumental projects require a significant amount of work behind the scenes, a little lost sleep and some fair amount of anxiety that happens along the way. That would be me, I think. As we know, there are so many folks to acknowledge who are part of this. I would like to particularly call out MHTN Architects, who helped us from the beginning of this project, Oakland Construction, that made this a reality, and there is one particular person that I'd really like to recognize. Certainly our entire university facilities management team was important, but I want to call out Lori Kaska from that team. Where is Lori? Lori, where are you? Yeah. So everybody look at Lori. Please wave. Yeah. I want you to know that Lori is special. She pays attention to every detail, so that we could ensure that the Carolyn and Kim Gardner building would honor the Gardners and their legacy here and would meet the needs of students, faculty, and staff for decades to come. We're grateful, Lori. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Dean Cindy Berg from the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences.
Thank you, Ruth. This is a wonderful day for the university community, as this is really a building for the community. Central to this building is that faculty, students, and staff are agents of change. And in order to make that change, we need to do it together. And the building has been designed, you'll see as you wander around, that intellectual exchanges between faculty and students can occur on every single floor. The College of Social and Behavioral Sciences is really committed to addressing today's grand challenges and inspiring human solutions to these challenges. We're tackling issues such as the growing obesity and diabetes crisis, air pollution, health policy, and together with our colleagues from the School of Cultural and Social Transformation, immigration policies and racist thought, all the easy stuff. We know that no single discipline can really tackle these challenges, and so we are really working together with different approaches and different disciplines coming together in this building. As you tour the facility, hopefully you'll go to the fifth floor at some point, and you're going to see students and faculty co-creating knowledge in really what's a very innovative space of anthropology and geography laboratories that are interconnected. Together with our environmental and sustainability studies, these labs are looking at issues of climate change. Faculty and students are all over. They're in the fields, in the ponds, and forests, not only here in Utah, but all over the West. They're also on glaciers in Greenland and in the Himalayas, examining how humans have adapted to these changes through archaeological work. Researchers are also conducting modern and ancient DNA analysis to explain variation in human health and migration patterns in the Meldrum ancient and modern DNA laboratories. On the third floor, you're going to see a new center, which Ruth mentioned, Nexus, anchored by the John H. Soar Nexus Core, that's providing faculty, students, and community leaders with space to engage in collaborative research. John and Mary Short's commitment to data-driven policies is really going to guide our vision. And adjacent to that facility is the Wasatch Front Secure Data Center, one of only 31 sites in the country, providing researchers and state leaders access to data on housing, health, and economics that has never been available before in this state. Team project rooms, you'll see them all over the place. They're allowing faculty and students to catalyze research and move those ideas forward in our Masters of Public Administration, Masters of Public Policy, and our MIOSH program. And throughout the building, innovative teaching occurs. You'll see different kinds of classrooms than this one. You'll see classrooms where there's an opportunity for group work. This is, again, in the spirit of really understanding how it is that we can learn. And our students are really learning the critical thinking, communication, and quantitative skills that will really allow them to make those solutions for the new challenges. In a few minutes, you'll see a video that sort of details some of that, and I hope you'll have an opportunity to walk around and look at the building as well. But the building is already becoming the place where students begin their exploration at the University of Utah through going to the Welcome Center and are guided through programs through our Student Success Center. Then through internships, both in the college and in the Hinckley Institute of Politics, and also experiences in the Office of Global Engagement, our students are going to take what they learn out into the world. It's not so easy out there in the real world. We're so grateful for all of you students for joining us to make the building possible. A special thank you to Madison Black Ebert, who, as Ruth mentioned, went to the legislature and was very instrumental for us. And I want to give a special thank you to President Watkins, whose vision, tenacity, perseverance, really made this building possible. She would be a great construction manager, Kim, because when obstacles come out, like, oh, that little IT thing that we didn't know about, she was like, very calmly, in sort of her Ruth way, says, that's fine, but get it together, and it's got to do it. So let's take a pause for President Watkins' leadership. We're so grateful to you, Carolyn, Kim, for making this building become a reality. I think you know it would not have become a reality without your help. We're really proud to claim Kim as an alumnus of the college, in addition to their children, Kimberly and Christian, and we're happy to adopt Carolyn as well. And Carolyn, thank you so much for your leadership. I know it was sort of your thrust that got it to the finish line here, so thank you so much. I want to add my thanks to all of the donors to our building, and every time I pass by your spaces, I think fondly of the lasting contribution that you've made to students and faculty. It was so gratifying to see this building just full of students using the space, honestly, as though it's always been here. And I'm also so grateful that they have spaces to sit. If you recall the old Osh, there was no place to sit except for that lovely linoleum floor. In the short 2 months since its opening, Gardner Commons has hosted already several forums and discussions jointly hosted by the Department of Political Science and the Hinckley Institute on topics such as civility in politics, the role of higher education in facilitating the American dream, a conference organized by the Department of Economics on the Great Polarization held in this auditorium and in the Eccles Auditorium. All of you who've contributed to the building have been really tremendous agents of change in your own communities, in Salt Lake and beyond, and it's really such an honor to stand on your shoulders to train students to be that next generation. As Ruth mentioned, we lost one of our giants this week, Rocco Siciliano, whose life was one of public service. And as his daughter Maria mentioned to me this week, it was really apt that he passed away on Election Day. His intellect, generosity, and approach to working within systems to affect change should be a model for all of us. And I can really hear his voice in this auditorium. You'll see a quote out in the gathering area. Our nation needs good citizens, beginning with the very young, to commit, to maintain, and to serve present and future needs. And it's some comfort to me, and I hope to the family as well, that this investment will touch the lives of faculty and students for generations to come, those who are really the change makers. So for all of you who've invested in this building through your philanthropy and your time, your investment will touch the lives for students and faculty for really generations to come, those who are the next wave of change makers. So a very heartfelt thank you to all of you from all of us on this campus.
Thank you, Dean Berg. I have the pleasure of serving on the CSBS Advancement Board, and I have loved getting to know you and Rob and many of the other dedicated board members who work tirelessly for the students and faculty of this college. My name is Kimberly. I am the oldest and the brightest, I might add, of Carolyn and Kim's six children. Sorry, I just say that to bother Christian. I am honored to represent my siblings at this wonderful event and would like to say a few words on their behalf. We are proud of the charitable instincts of our parents. We have such admiration and love for them and are grateful for their example of their outstanding generosity in this community. Most importantly, we are so blessed our family can make this kind of a gift to the University of Utah, an institution that we all love. At the groundbreaking and demolition of OSH, the chamber choir sang a thrilling rendition of Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho and the walls came tumbling down. Hallelujah! And I can't wait to hear what they are going to sing today. I am very sad that I was not able to sing with them when I was at this, because I would have just been such a choir nerd, it would have been so fun. But anyway, many of you know and have had the pleasure, or the pain, of hearing my father recite the poetry of Emily Dickinson. He has chosen one of his favorite lyrical meditations of her poetry for the building entrance. Not knowing when the dawn will come, I open every door. I'll let you, Dad, finish the rest of it. But this poem perfectly captures my parents' vision of Gardner Commons. Students do not know all that they will face in their lives, nor the challenges that await them. Hopefully, in this building, they will open every door of opportunity and knowledge to prepare them for what lies ahead. We hope students take classes outside of their comfort zone, wrestle with concepts that are confounding, explore new ideas, and develop a lifelong love of learning and knowledge. We are envious of this new classroom building and the many advantages it offers. My mother wanted places in this building for students to study and socialize and eat. Mom was the driving force in encouraging our support for this building. We support the scholarships and other contributions of our parents and look forward to adding to them. In addition to the financial donation from the family, I want to acknowledge the role of my brother, Christian, and the Gardner Company throughout the atrium for this building construction. When the initial bids came in, the building costs were substantially higher than the budget would allow. The choices were to either remove or reduce programs in the building or reduce the costs. The Gardner Company, under Christian's direction, oversaw the value engineering that saved almost $20 million and made way for the inclusion of the Eccles Welcome Center, the Hinckley Institute, as well as other amenities. This Gardner family has fond feelings for the university. Christian, Andrew, and I have followed in our parents' footsteps, graduated here. My oldest daughter is a student in the Honors College, and I'm sure many of the 30 grandchildren of Mom and Dad will also be proud Utes. My parents started the tradition of the Gardner family giving generously to the university, and I can say with confidence their children and grandchildren will continue on this legacy of giving and honoring their commitment to education well into the future. Our family will always look upon this building with pride and gratitude that we could be numbered among the many, many donors that make this university a place of excellence. Thank you.
With all the Let's see. Thank you very much. What a privilege to be here today. I just want to introduce the president of our choir, Lexi Davis, who has a quick presentation.
Well, in honor of everything that the Garners have brought to the university, and especially to our University of Utah Chamber Choir, we just wanted to dedicate that song to them. That arrangement was written just for them, The Wind Beneath My Wings, because they are the wind beneath our wings. So we would like to present them with this plaque, and it's to commemorate this event and everything that you guys have done for us. It is the first page of this piece, and it's 22. We also would like to present them with this DVD. We went to China and Taiwan last year on tour, and they made that possible for us. And we have a DVD of our concert for them from the Taiwanese Concert Hall. So that's also for you.
Thank you again, Barlow Bradford, and the magnificent University Chamber Choir. The choir is really my first love here at the university. They are just an outstanding choir, and Barlow Bradford, what can I say about him that hasn't been said? He's a magnificent director, composer, arranger, professor, and he does achieve great heights with this choir. And he also holds the presidential chair in my mother's name for choral music at the university. So we're deeply, deeply proud of Barlow and the University Chamber Choir. It was about 2 weeks ago that Kim and I attended the concert of Josh Groban down at the Vivint Center. And when they sang the song, "You Raise Me Up," I thought of the words, and I quote, "When I am on your shoulders, you raise me up to be more than I can be." And I thought that was appropriate for today as we think of the wonderful professors and mentors this building will house. And they will do just that for the many thousands and thousands of students who will study here. We're grateful today for our many family members who could be with us, and for many of our special friends who also made it possible to, in their lives and their schedules, to be here with us today as well. And has been said, it was about 2 years ago that we met in President Pershing's office, along with President Watkins, and we discussed the replacement of the Osh building. Well, the Osh held many wonderful memories for both Kim and myself, as we had many of our classes there. Our children all attend classes there, and now a granddaughter here attending the U as well. And like this building, Osh was the main classroom building for the university. It was a place of great learning from great professors. It was also a place of socializing where we could meet with our friends and study, or make dates for study groups, or just compare notes, or just plain hang out. But as the years went by, we all recognized that it was time for a change to a new, more modern building. A building with better earthquake protection. A building where students could have some food offered to them in the cafeteria. Places to study and socialize with friends. A building that would provide ample room for bigger classrooms. More space for students to set up their tablets and their computers, and better offices for professors, and a better home for the departments of social and behavioral sciences and political science, and a building that could house a university welcome center and also the Hinckley Institute. So yes, it was time for a change. And as you walk through this building, you'll notice several little alcoves that are provided for students to kind of sit in this little place and do their work and plug in their computers. Well, as I thought of our 30 grandchildren, whom we hope will attend the University of Utah, I said to Kim, this is something that we need to do. And because of my urging, he said, okay, we'll do this, but your name's gonna go first on the building. But regardless of that, I think the university could always have more women names on buildings here. When I came to the U from back east, I brought with me my Smith Corona typewriter. Now, I know that ages me, but I can also remember going to the bookstore and purchasing many heavy textbooks that I would have to carry around from classroom to classroom. But now, with the new technology, you can download all the books you need and take notes on your computers and your tablets. So yes, times have changed, and yes, we need to change to meet up with those current conditions that are so necessary now. And don't forget the insulated mugs that the students carry around that enable them to sip their breakfast through a straw as they hurry to classes, or to keep their carbonated drinks hot or cold to keep them awake during class as well. Well, at the main entrance to this building, we have given some thought to and listed some of our aspirations we hope that the students here will take advantage of as they study here. And bear with me for a minute. We hope the students will be open to ideas, free from prejudice, with a desire to continue learning, thinking critically, and writing persuasively throughout their lives. We hope the students will appreciate social, behavioral, and historical heritage that is the basis of our society. We hope that the students will embrace a global perspective that recognizes equality for all. We hope they will learn to strive to better humanity through service. We hope they will think deeply about philosophy, religion, and the purpose of our existence here on Earth. We hope they will cultivate strong interpersonal relationships with family and friends and other mentors that they may meet along the way. And lastly, we hope they will live interesting and fulfilling lives, enjoying current events, politics, sports, literature, art, and music. In closing, we hope that the University of Utah students will enjoy learning from great professors just as we did. And we know they will make and create memorable, wonderful memories and look back on their time here as one of great fulfillment and enjoyment, just as we have. When I think back on our years here as students struggling and as poor as we were to get by, to get our degrees, it was never ever in our wildest dreams did we ever think that one day the university would honor us with our names on such a wonderful building. So thank you very much. Kemp joins me in saying, a Utah fan am I. Thank you.
Don't worry, there's only one or two words on each page. I'm getting so old. Carolyn talks about her wildest dreams. Mitt had that great quote where I would say, Carolyn, in your wildest dreams, did you ever think that we'd have our name on this building? And she'd say, Kim, you've never been in my wildest dreams. You know, I'm a Ute supporter. I wear a red coat and a red tie and a red shirt, and I have a red face. And I support the Red Sox. I'm really happy that that's one winning team I've got right now. So many of you are Ute supporters as well. And we all give scholarships and we all give back in some way. And we've kind of dabbled around the edges where we've got our names in the Policy Institute and the Student Life Center and the Music Department and the Alumni House and the Student Life Center and the even the basketball practice facility. But the university's decided to bring our names out into the open, into the light. And we're excited. We couldn't be more excited. However, as I look at this beautiful building, I struggle with the name. It's not common at all. It's a beautiful building. Well, we're very thankful to our many friends who've come today, and to President Pershing and to Ruth, President Watkins, who have encouraged us and helped make this possible. One of my granddaughters asked me if she needed to go to the U or could she go away to another school. And I said, well, I think that you could go away to graduate school for a couple of years. That would be a good experience. But it would probably be helpful for you to go to school where you're going to live, because that's where you're going to make friends, and that's where you're going to have continued association with your professors. And I only said that because I had such great teachers here at the University of Utah and friends that continue to make an impact in my life. The university's experience goes on throughout your life, not just here. I mean, if I hadn't have come here, I would have never met Roger. And I would have never had the money to build this or to help here. That's a good example. But my hope for this building, oh, by the way, I would have never met James Fletcher. And when he was head of NASA and I was working with Senator Mostyn, he was over the Senate Aeronautical and Space Science. President Fletcher made sure that Carolyn and I went to the Apollo launches and the Skylabs and flew with NASA. I mean, we were big shots. It was nice to know your college president back there. My hope for this building is that it will continue to house great teachers who are passionate and inspiring and know their subject matter, but love students and want to see students succeed. And above all, teachers that will have an open door policy. Students will feel their influence throughout their lives. I had those teachers here, and I'm just going to name a few of them. I know it's boring for you, but I just want to name a couple of them. Neil Maxwell, Obert Tanner, Waldemar P. Reed, James Clayton, John Flynn, Arvo Van Alstyne, and J.D. Williams. I continued my association with many of those for many years. I took 3 classes from Neil, but then we served together on the State Board of Regents and on other educational committees. And he had something to do with our going to Boston on an LDS church mission. And his extensive vocabulary and elegant style of speaking and writing and his knowledge of politics just so impressed me. And I have to tell you that I count the multiple times I went to 47 East South Temple for lunch to be high points in my life. Waldemar Reed was the chair of the philosophy department when I was here, and I took his theory courses. And one time, after struggling with his contextualism instead of absolutes, that's a different issue, he said, Kim, I live down on 11th East. I'll be there this afternoon. Walk down and sit on the porch with me. Now, how many professors do that? It changed my life. He taught me that even though Sunday is the Sabbath day and should be kept holy, that in the context of a conflicting situation, you act on the basis of the probability of a preponderant value, which is supporting the Pac-12 and the Utes. And that it's all right for me to sit on the front row at the basketball games. I mean, the ox is in the mire. One of the brilliant research and constitutional scholars was James Clayton. And we've had many things to do with him over the years. But when I chaired the search committee for the new president of the university, I asked James Clayton, my great friend and brilliant scholar, to represent the faculty, and he guided us through that search, and I've always been grateful to him. I want to mention John Flynn at the law school, because I have a good memory, but that doesn't mean I can think. And John helped point that out to me. That the thing in law school is you have to learn to think critically and write persuasively. That's why that's on that list. And it made a big difference. He guided me in my writing to where I actually won the Stephen Trainer Award for Outstanding Legal Writing in my junior year. And I've always been grateful for a professor that could help you that way. I want to then just mention Obert Tanner. Everyone knows Obert Tanner. I had his religious or his philosophy of religion course, and he taught me about service and philanthropy, and of course about beauty. Truth is beauty, beauty's truth, you know, his great quote of Keats. And after school, or after our college, Obert encouraged me to join him in the Timpanogos Club, and then to help on the symphony board, and then to help with the building of the symphony, the Abravanel Hall. And I was so astounded when he put gold leaf on all of the walls of that building, because it was beautiful, it was beauty, and it was art. I loved Obert Tanner. In fact, I would just want to mention, Obert's gone now, but his company donates the gold, silver, and bronze medals for the Days of 47 Rodeo. I grew very close to Arvo Van Alstyne, that great law professor and university administrator. And when I chaired the Regents, and we were looking for a commissioner and we were struggling, I called Obert, who was teaching a course in Ohio for the summer. I didn't call Obert, I called Arvo. And I said, would you even consider coming back and being the commissioner of higher education in Utah? And he did. And he was absolutely amazing in getting the higher education on track, but only for 2 short years. It broke my heart when he died so suddenly. Well, maybe I'm still heartbroken. A real hero for me was that passionate J.D. Williams, who taught Carolyn and me, and I think Kimberly and maybe Christian, in political science. He always had an open door, and he even let me correct some of his exams or students' exams when I was in law school to help us get through. And I can't tell you how many times he had us over for dinner or took us to lunch. He encouraged me to get involved in politics. When I was looking at whether to volunteer for the Hubert Humphrey for President campaign, J.D. was the one, you've got to do this. This will be a great experience for you. And it did. It led me to, at the age of 28, to be the chief of staff for Senator Moss in Washington. And I've always appreciated his interest in students and in the Hinckley Institute. I was invited back many times by him and also by my good friend Ted Wilson, who's here. It would be hard to find a better lecturer and motivator of students. Well, the university has always had learned and passionate teachers who guide students, not just in their studies, but in their lives. God bless teachers. And may they find joy in their profound and important callings in this new classroom building. Thank you very much.
Gardner Commons represents yet another way that students can learn about science.
A place like this really inspires me to come back and get my master's in public administration.
This new building really represents, you know, the direction and the future of the University of Utah.
This building is really quite special.
This facility is going to really help me to further my own research, where I can collaborate with different folks from anthropology and environmental studies. We can all kind of work together on interdisciplinary projects.
It's really cool to come in and see everybody learning in this communal space. I see lots of students working together in the hallways and in classrooms, and it's a great environment.
We're really proud to have the Wasatch Front Research Data Center. Again, it's right here in the Gardner Commons building. It is a secure facility. Unfortunately, it is so secure, we can't show it to you. Researchers, they will be able to get access to this restricted data that the federal government holds. That is going to be a great injection of results that are going to help Utah and the country.
Inside is beautiful. There's tons of natural light. The big windows are amazing.
Gardner Commons offers students more opportunities now to see what's possible. Students are able to actually walk by the laboratory and look in the windows where students can watch what we're doing in the laboratory. I've had several students already approach me about doing small projects in my laboratory.
It's a great building. It has a lot of place to collaborate with other students. I even come here with students from other departments, and it's a great place to meet.
So the space is a big game changer. Everything is centrally located. It's a great space, very open.
I love everything about this place, and I'm so excited to see all of the awesome opportunities I have here.
And shout out to Chartwells for keeping the food coming and keeping it good.
The Gardner Commons is an excellent facility where we can train young scientists that will then go on to do great things in the world.
There's no other place in the U.S. that has this kind of facility for their students.
It matters when you come into a space that is inviting, flexible. Everybody wants to come and meet in this building, and it just sort of draws you in.
Wow. Carolyn, Kem, thank you for helping us in our quest to be the model public research university in our nation. Much good is happening here. There is so much to celebrate today and so much to be proud of. As I think about this building, what I am the most proud of is the way our campus community has come together in really an unprecedented way in this building that is the hub of the University of Utah. It is rare to have this combination of academic space, of student affairs, of the voice of our students, our faculty, and our staff coming together to create a building that will make a difference for generations to come. One of the things that we have really been emphasizing in our current and future at the University of Utah is what is possible for us when we think and act as one university. This building, the Carolyn and Kem Gardner Commons, is the 1U mission in action. I am so proud and I am so grateful. Please. And in the spirit of 1U, instead of the conventional ribbon cutting, we are going to do a ribbon joining. So I think this will require a bit of magic, but we have some ribbons to be joined. So Kimberly, Carolyn, Kem, Cindy, Connor, Amy, come on down and join me, and we'll do some ribbon joining. As we're getting everyone assembled, let me tell you that there is yet one more thing to celebrate, and that is that as you go travel around the building, see the spaces, you will also have nice food and snacks along the way. So please do take the time to look at the building and enjoy some camaraderie as you do so and see these beautiful spaces that you've been hearing about. All right. Lab tours as well. So food, lab tours, gathering up the gardeners. All right, very good. No, that's good. One missing person?
But we're good.
All right.
He's been missing for quite a while.
All right, ribbon joiners. So.
Here, Dad,
No, you're too tiny. Hurry, quick.